Hello, I hope you're doing well. Welcome to a relaxing little chat about almost all things Naruto and Naruto Shippuden, the anime. We've been watching the anime series of both of them for about a year now. Haven't read the manga, though I'm pretty sure about 80% of the anime, you know, maybe 80-90% is close to the manga. I'm sure there's some stuff that happens in the anime that's, you know, doesn't take place in the manga. But for the most part, I'm, especially when it comes to the major characters and the story arcs, etc., that the anime is pretty much the same as the source material. So there's two things I like to say first. Number one is there will be spoilers. We are up to season 4, episode 213 of Naruto Shippuden. So if you haven't gotten that far, you may want to get that far before watching any more of this, because some, you know, there will be some reveals in this video. And the second thing I want to say is if you see me occasionally glancing over off camera, it's because I'm referencing the many pages of notes that I've written down so that I can keep this little chat as organized as possible, and so that I don't forget anything, especially when it comes to, you know, all the different, the main characters, and, you know, we'll go over them, their powers, and some of the different plot points, or, you know, some of the major things that have happened in the anime. So, in case you're wondering how I got into Naruto and Naruto Shippuden, last year, 2021, our son started watching it, and then eventually my wife and I started watching it with him as well. And at first I was like, you know, what is this, some kind of childish thing about kids, you know, fighting bad guys and all that, right? So I once again made the mistake of judging a book by its cover. Incorrectly so, because as we began to watch more and more of Naruto, I realized that there is it has a lot of depth. The characters have depth. It's somewhat mature. There is the original Naruto is a little, you know, all the characters are young, so there's a little more, you know, goofiness and silliness and not so mature as Naruto Shippuden. But I found out, you know, it's, you know, there's, like I said, a lot of depth, a lot of good stories, and a lot of, you know, of course, cool powers and abilities, and it's just very original anime. We haven't seen Dragon Ball Z or any other anime that might be similar to Naruto. So I don't really know how original Naruto is, it's great. Absolutely have fallen in love with it, and we've been watching it, you know, at least, you know, 2-3 times a week, a couple episodes every night. After we finished watching Naruto, we moved on to Naruto Shippuden, and wow. Talk about maturing. Not only do the characters mature by a few years, but still they, you know, they become older, which is cool to see, because many in many anime or cartoons, usually the characters will remain the same age forever, right? So that was cool. But it also matures in terms of the story, and even the content. It's a lot more violent, bloody, and there's even some scenes that are borderline torture. in terms of when some of the characters or the Jinchuriki are getting their tailed beasts extracted from them. And of course, some characters die permanently. I'm not sure if any characters die in the original Naruto, but in Naruto Shippuden, characters start to die off, and that's not cool, but I think it's cool because it just, you know, that's life. That's one thing I absolutely love about manga and anime and the Japanese culture and the medium and the people. They're not afraid to portray real life and things that happen in real life in their mediums, especially with the anime and cartoons. Being a lifelong American myself, it's still refreshing to see, because our cartoons and our TV shows, like, no one ever dies. It's all very, we play it safe a lot here in the United States with our mediums, because we're afraid to offend anyone or shock anyone. I don't know. It's definitely different. And like most good anime, whether it's Attack on Titan or A Silent Voice, there are some scenes in Naruto Shippuden, especially, that tug on your heartstrings. And there's some emotional, touching moments, especially with some characters that end up dying. So that's another great aspect. Again, I didn't realize the anime was based on a manga, but I'm glad there is an anime, because with all the different manga and anime and movies and video games and on-demand shows, etc., etc., there's just so much entertainment out there that, you know, as much as I would love to own every manga in existence, and comic book, and regular works of fiction, it's just, you know, impossible. So I'm glad there's an anime for some of these manga titles. One thing I love about anime versus manga or any anime, cartoon, or movie that's especially based on a book or a manga, comic book, is having voices put to the characters. And I absolutely love the English dubs for Naruto and Naruto Shippuden. All the characters have distinct and unique voices, and so you know when one of them is speaking in the English dub, you know who that character is. Now, of course, I'm not Japanese, so when listening to the original Japanese, it's really hard to make that distinction between the different Japanese male voices or the female Japanese voices. I hate to say this, but they all kind of sound the same. Now, of course, maybe if I was Japanese, I would be able to notice a distinct sound between the different Japanese voice actors, but I can't, and we can't. Now, we've been watching Naruto and Naruto Shippuden. I think the original Naruto, all of it is available on Netflix. I can't remember. But Naruto Shippuden, I believe, is all the episodes are only available on Hulu, I believe. Or at least the original Japanese. Now, Hulu makes 140, about the first 140 episodes of Naruto Shippuden available in English dub, but there's about 700 episodes, and in order to listen to the dub of those, you have to spend about $20 for about 12 episodes, so you'd have to spend about $300 or $400 just to listen to the remaining English dub of Naruto Shippuden. That's because it's owned by Viz Media, and for whatever reason, they are not releasing the English dub for, you know, any on-demand service, whether it's Crunchyroll or whoever. I hate to say this, I think Viz Media is being a little greedy. I think at this point in time, with how long Naruto and Naruto Shippuden have been out, now that they could release the English all episodes of the English dub, but that's just my little 2 cents. Okay, so like I said, we are up to season 4, episode 213. The next episode we have to start watching is 214, and basically we just finished watching Pain wipe out the Hidden Leaf Village. So they are recuperating from that, trying to rebuild. Lady Tsunade, or Grandma Tsunade, is in a coma. Naruto eventually was able to talk Pain out and make Pain come to his senses, Nagato. And so, as just before he died, Pain gave or implanted the Rinnegan into Naruto, I believe. And then, let's just go over all of the different major, stories and plot points that have kind of occurred between Naruto and Naruto Shippuden. All right, so in Naruto, their first real mission was going after Zabuza in the Land of Waves. He was the guy with the giant sword and has cloth wrapped around like the lower part of his face. That was like their first real mission. And then there was the Chunin exams, where we get to see most of the main characters interact with each other for the first time. Maybe most of the main characters from the different clans and villages are introduced for the first time, and they meet up and battle each other. We have, and some of these aren't necessarily in the right order, the different stories that I'm going to be going over here. We have Orochimaru ends up giving Sasuke the curse mark so that Orochimaru can eventually use Sasuke's body and corrupt Sasuke, make him one of his little slaves, so to speak. We have Sasuke going rogue, becoming a rogue ninja, and leaving the Hidden Village not long after the Chunin exams, as he, of course, goes on his mission to seek revenge for what his older brother Itachi did to his family. So he wants to basically kill his older brother. We see a big battle between Sasuke and Naruto at a waterfall area. I think that was before Sasuke left the village and went rogue, probably around the same time, I can't remember. But we get to see them square off and use their powers against each other, and they're pretty much equal, except I think Naruto got knocked out and Sasuke could have killed him, but he didn't. And I think at that point, I think he goes rogue after that. Then there is the death of the third Hokage, which is like the first major tragedy in the first series of Naruto. And eventually Tsunade becomes the fourth. No, that's right. Tsunade becomes the fifth Hokage. Tsunade is the fifth Hokage, but the third Hokage was still alive, I guess. And then, I forget how all that works out, but anyway, and the third Hokage was killed, I think, in a fight with Orochimaru, and the third Hokage tried to kill Orochimaru, but only ended up sealing his arms, or damaging Orochimaru's arms. And then there's the fight between Naruto and Orochimaru, when Naruto and Sakura and Kakashi, Team 7, were in the process of tracking down and trying to find Sasuke. And that was when we get to see Naruto become the tailed beast, or at least four tails emerged. And we saw Naruto as the nine-tailed beast for an extended period of time. I think we saw it briefly here and there in previous episodes, but it was when Naruto was fighting Orochimaru with the four tails emerged. When we saw a little bit more of what Naruto was capable of. And then there was the fight between Asuma, Shikamaru, and I forget who the third character was, when they caught up to two of the Akatsuki, who I think were looking for the nine-tailed beast, Hidan and Kakuzu. And it was Hidan, that eventually ends up killing Asuma. And I think that was the first character, one of the first shinobi of the series of the Hidden Leaf that ends up getting killed. And that was a bit touching because there was a lot of some backstory and flashbacks you get about Asuma. We get to learn about his life a little bit and his relationship with Shikamaru and all that. So it was a bit touching to see a character like Asuma, leader of Team 10, I think, or something like that, get killed. It definitely tugged on my heartstrings. Let's see what else took place. There was the scene where Pervy Sage, aka Jiraiya, was saying goodbye to Tsunade as he was going on his mission to, I forget exactly, he ends up at the village of Hidden Rain, where Pain is the leader, but I forget exactly why he was going there. I know to gather information or find out maybe if that's where the leader of the Akatsuki is, something like that. And this scene with between Jiraiya and Tsunade is quite long, kind of drawn out. It's quite a drawn out goodbye. So you just get the feeling that this is the last time that Jiraiya and Tsunade will see each other. You also get we get to see some flashbacks when they were young. So that was kind of cool. This is one great thing about this anime. And, a lot of good animes, you get a lot of backstory behind the characters, flashbacks to when they were young. And Jiraiya, I think, had somewhat of a crush. I think they might have both had a crush on each other or something like that. He ends up saying goodbye to Tsunade, and I think she gets the feeling it's the last time that she's going to see him. And of course, he ends up finding the village of the Hidden Rain, where Pain, Nagato, is the leader. And unfortunately, we see Jiraiya get killed by Pain. He did his best, especially in Sage mode, to defeat Pain, but it just wasn't quite enough. But he was able to warn the Hidden Leaf, about the information he found out. And that was very touching, because Jiraiya was liked his voice and liked him as a character. He was a good guy, he loved his women, and he loved doing his research for his books. it was kind of sad, watching Jiraiya, get killed. It just was, never expected it. Never really expect that the way that they, the anime, the way that things take place is sometimes you don't really know what's about to happen, and you try to guess, but then Jiraiya actually getting killed, you think, they're not going to kill Jiraiya, and then they do, right? You think maybe he'll escape somehow or something like that, but that's what I love about this anime and animes like it, is just how authentic they are with killing off characters. You rarely see characters permanently killed in, you know, comic books here in the United States or what have you, except for like The Walking Dead, which was the first comic that I've ever seen. Because when I started to read The Walking Dead comic book, it was before I, you know, found out about manga, and The Walking Dead comic book was the first time I've seen actual characters in a comic book get killed permanently and not come back because of some kind of ridiculous, you know, whatever. You know, Superman gets killed, comes back, Batman, Captain America, you know, get killed, comes back, blah, blah, blah. You know, there's no tricks. All right, so what else happens? There, between Naruto and Naruto Shippuden, we find out between the two series that Naruto has been training for about 3 years with Jiraiya. We don't really see it. We see it's kind of implied between what takes place in Naruto and then 3 years later where Naruto Shippuden starts. So the Naruto was like 13, I think, at the end of Naruto, the original series, and then we find out he's 16 in Naruto Shippuden. But yeah, we find out between those two, between that time, he was training with Jiraiya so he could get up to the level of Sasuke. Then there's also Naruto training with Jiraiya and Kakashi to, again, advance his, I think this might have been that same time period. I don't know. It might not be. I think it's separate. I think he learns fire and wind, something that he can counter Sasuke with, because Sasuke, I think, could use two, lightning, and I forget what else. So Naruto was trying to learn, I think, two other chakra forces, or chakra natures. I forget which exactly. And then we have one of the next story plot points are Team 7 eventually finding Sasuke at Orochimaru's hideout after Sasuke killed Orochimaru. And we get a little foreshadowing of that, of them meeting with Sasuke in the beginning, like the first episode of Naruto Shippuden. We get a glimpse of Naruto, Sakura, and Kakashi, and Sai in this like little crater, this blown out hole in the ground, and Sasuke standing up outside of the hole looking down at them. And so that was kind of foreshadowed in the first episode of Naruto Shippuden, if I remember correctly. And then we finally get to see that, what takes place, you know, around episode 130 or something like that. There's the moment when Gaara ends up fighting the Akatsuki, a couple of the Akatsuki members, but then eventually he ends up getting kidnapped and having his tailed beast extracted from him. And that was kind of brutal to watch a little bit. I mean, Gaara was being held in some kind of chakra bubble, and the whole time he's screaming and moaning in pain as the tailed beast is being extracted, like, out of his eyes and his mouth and everything. And for me, I'm a little bit older, and you know, have a son, so you know, things tend to, you know, pull on my heartstrings a little bit more than, you know, when I might have been, you know, young and single. But that was like borderline torture, really. So there's some brutal, harsh moments like that, but they don't go, you know, too far. So that happened. And then there was Itachi in Kisame, I forget how you pronounce that Akatsuki member's name. They visited the Hidden Leaf, I think, around the time of the Chunin exams. I forget exactly why, but there was that which took place. Then there was the meeting of the Kages, where Danzo, gets appointed as temporary 6th Hokage before he ends up escaping because Sasuke tracks him down. And then eventually there's the fight between Sasuke and Danzo where, and we'll get into a little bit about Danzo in a little bit, but he's got a bunch of eyes on his arms. He ends up getting killed though. And that's pretty much where we're at in the story, just a few episodes after all that took place. There's also Sasuke finally meeting up with Itachi, as well as Tobi, or Obito, or who we think is, or is Madara, Uchiha. And Sasuke learns the whole truth about what happened to his clan, as well as Itachi. And that's when Sasuke decides to take his revenge on and go after the Hidden Leaf Village. And then the last big thing to happen is Sakura ends up finding and meeting up with Sasuke, with her saying she wants to join him. So she feels guilty and somewhat for what's happened to Sasuke and how Naruto is still trying to save Sasuke, and the promise that she made to, with Naruto, that to help bring Sasuke back. So I think she's trying to do whatever she can to save Sasuke. So see how that turns out. All right, let's move on to a lot of the main characters and their abilities or powers. Now, obviously, there are hundreds of characters, but we're going to go over the most notable characters, the more notable enemies, as well as most of the main characters from the Hidden Leaf Village. So first up, we have the star of the show, Naruto, who we find out is the son of the 4th Hokage, which was a big reveal, and that just happened, not too long ago, around episode 200 or something like that. We find that when Naruto is in the battle with Pain, I believe, and he ends up, I think the Nine-Tailed Beast comes out, and because the Nine-Tailed Beast is in control, Naruto has kind of regressed into his own mind, and the Nine-Tailed Beast wants Naruto to remove the final seal that keeps the beast, somewhat detained from completely coming out. And that's at the point where Naruto meets his dad, because his dad had a part of himself or his memories or his chakra sealed in that seal that keeps the Nine-Tailed Beast sealed away inside Naruto. So that was really cool. And that's another thing that I love about anime and manga, is the character development. They're human. They don't really, they have some powers, but they're not superhuman. They still have their human weaknesses. They can die. They struggle. They have emotions. They experience love and sorrow and joy. And they love Ichiraku Ramen, I think is the name of the restaurant where Naruto always gets his ramen from. So that was cool. Naruto meeting his father. That was a great reveal. And there was some backstory to that, and how Jiraiya was knew Naruto's father. And of course, Naruto mostly uses his abilities. He mostly uses his shadow clone jutsu and his Rasengan. And of course, sometimes the Nine Tails Beast emerges from Naruto, so he'll have that power. But when he's really, angry, it's kind of like Bruce Banner and the Hulk in that regard. And because Naruto has a tailed beast sealed within him, he's known as a Jinchuriki. And I'll go over all the different, I'll go over that a little bit, as well as the different nine-tailed beasts after we go through the different characters. Of course, we have Sasuke, Naruto's friend. Well, Naruto sees Sasuke as a friend. Sasuke doesn't see Naruto or anyone really as a friend right now. He's completely consumed by hate and revenge. Sasuke, being a member of the Uchiha clan, has the Sharingan in both eyes, as well as the Mangekyo Sharingan, which is a more powerful version of it. And he also has the power of the Chidori, some kind of lightning chakra power, I believe, lightning style. And I think Kakashi also can use the Chidori. And then we have Sakura. She's in love with Sasuke. Again, he's not really in love with her. Of course, Sakura is, you know, as we now know, up to episode 213, she has, you know, finally caught up with Sasuke. She has a really powerful strength or strong punch, and the ability to heal. She's a medical ninja. Next, we have the fifth Hokage, or known as Granma Tsunade by Naruto. You don't really see her use her powers too much. She's usually behind a desk giving everyone missions, or, you know, screaming and yelling at Naruto. Currently, she's in a coma because she used all of her powers to save everyone in the Hidden Leaf during Pain's attack. She uses her personal summon, Katsuyu, a giant slug, and it can split into smaller slugs that can swallow people. Kind of like when Luke Skywalker, like when Han Solo cut open that creature in Empire Strikes Back, and he put a Luke into its belly to keep him warm. Kind of like that. They just get swallowed up in the snail's stomachs, the snail's bodies, and the snails protect them that way and also heal them that way too, I believe. And then we have Kakashi, leader of Team 7, I believe, right? One of my favorite characters. I love the voice actor for him. He's like the silent, cool, and smart type. Absolutely love his character in the anime. He's a great leader and a great teacher and a great friend. Just an all-around great guy, Kakashi. He has a Sharingan in his left eye. That was given to him, I believe, from one of his teammates, who was from a clan Uchiha, if I'm not mistaken. I think it's mostly the Uchiha clan that has the Sharingans, but I might be mistaken on that. But yeah, his young teammate was crushed under some rocks or something, and as he was about to die, he passed his he gave his Sharingan to Kakashi. Kakashi uses the lightning blade. I think he has the lightning nature. I think he can master two natures, at least this far into the series so far. I think eventually he's able to master all five. Fire, water, earth, lightning, and wind. And because Danzo is dead or missing, I think Kakashi has been, the meeting of the Kages, I think they temporarily appointed Kakashi as the temporary Hokage of the Hidden Leaf. And of course, you know, Kakashi is the leader of Team 7, Sasuke, Naruto. Naruto and Sakura. And of course, they are about to meet up with Sasuke. You know, Sakura has found Sasuke. And I think there's going to be like a bit of a reunion that's going to take place. That's what it seems like. All right, then we have Jiraiya, also known as the Pervy Sage, always doing his, quote, research for his books, which usually involves women in hot baths or saunas. So he's a playa. and Kakashi always seems to be reading Jiraiya's mature books. Of course, Jiraiya was a sage, and he learned his powers from that village of toads. And he was also a Sannin, one of the three legendary ninja. Jiraiya, Tsunade, and Orochimaru were known as the three Sannin. And he can use, Jiraiya can use a giant Rasengan, can also grow his hair real long to bind his opponents. And of course, he has Sage Mode, where he gets really powerful. And he gets two toads that will aid him. They'll sit on his shoulders and increase his power. Next, we have Kiba and his dog, Akamaru. They are part of Team 8 and the Sasuke recovery team. They're a cool tandem. They have a keen sense of smell. Kiba often uses smoke bombs and has a certain chakra technique. One of the abilities is Fang Over Fang, where he attacks in this whirlwind type of attack. And of course he has a shadow clone and a transformation technique as well, I believe. But they're a cool little character, the boy and his dog. And then we have Asuma, who was the leader of Team 10, which consisted of Shikamaru, Ino, and Choji. One of the first characters to die, I believe, aside from the Hokage. I might be mistaken, though. Asuma had these knives with points on them or something like that, I forget. Very sharp and curved, which he could infuse with his chakra nature, or his chakra. He had some powers where he could release a powerful stream of wind, as well as an explosive cloud that would burn anyone caught in it. And of course, he was unfortunately killed by Hidan, one of the Akatsuki members, when they found Hidan and Kakazu were on the, in the land of fire. And we'll get to all the Akatsuki members in a little bit. Next we have Shikamaru. I love his character. Again, the way that he's voiced in the English dubs. He has a bit of a rough voice, I think. He was somewhat a pupil and admirer, looked up to Asuma. And Shikamaru is a member of the Nara clan. So his ability is, or they are known for, the shadow imitation technique. So basically, Shikamaru can use a shadow, or his own shadow, to attack his opponents, to bind them, to control their movements, things like that. Next we have Hinata. She is in love with Naruto. She's really cute. She's shy. Whenever Naruto is around, she's always blushing. She gets real shy. I believe in the third series, Boruto, that Naruto and Hinata are married. So I'm assuming at some point, that might take place at the end of Naruto Shippuden. I know that during the battle with Pain, with Naruto, that Hinata tried to come to Naruto's rescue, which was really cool, cute. And she's got, she has some abilities and power. Unfortunately, she got killed. But fortunately, Nagato, or Pain, revived everyone with his reanimation jutsu, or the forbidden jutsu, I think. And she and Neji are from the same clan, so they have similar powers. They have the Byakugan, the ability to see through objects all around them in a 360-degree field. So they're good trackers and scouts. And they can also use the 8 trigrams, 64 palms technique, where they keep punching you in the chest with their palms. 6 palms, 12 palms, 24 palms, until your internal organs are destroyed or whatever. I believe Hinata has the mystical palm technique where she can heal people. All right, and then we have Guy. He is the leader of Team Guy with Rock Lee, Neji, and Ten-Ten. He has great physical prowess and strength, the ability to use the eight inner gates. I love the way he's voiced. He's got that just, overly confident, that's right, Lee. He's always talking like that. But he has the power to use these eight inner gates. I think he tried to use them in the fight when Pain was attacking the Hidden Leaf. I think he unlocked some of the gates, and each one of those gates that he opens gives him a unique power. And for most of the episodes that I've seen, we don't really get to see Guy fight all that much. But maybe in future episodes we will. And then we have Ten-Ten. She originally wanted to be a medical ninja like Lady Tsunade, but realized she didn't have that kind of chakra power. So she dedicated her life to using weapons, which she excels at. She's like the best, weapons artist. And she uses scrolls to store her weapons in them, and then she can summon the weapons from the scrolls when needed. Then we have Yamato. I like him. He's a part of Team Kakashi. I believe he can control the earth and water natures. And with that, he can make wood, control the wood style. So he can create barriers, buildings, or wrap wood around his opponents to crush them or to keep them held in place. He can grow wood and trees from his body, like out of his arms. And he can also create wood-based clones. He also has, some kind of symbol on his hand, so he could suppress the power of a tailed beast, most notably suppressing Naruto's nine-tailed beast. So you'll often find Yamato around Naruto in the later episodes of Naruto Shippuden. Next we have Ino. She was a part of Asuma's Team 10. She has some medical powers. She can detect changes in someone's chakra, and she can possess a target and take control of them. Don't see her too much in action. Choji, another member of Asuma's Team 10, Choji, like me, loves food, loves to eat. He can turn himself into like a giant version of himself, or into a human bullet tank and run over his enemies. And he does this by taking certain pills, which turn the fat in his body into chakra to increase his powers. Then we have Chojuro. He's a character from the Land of Mist that was just introduced during the meeting of the Kages. So haven't really seen him in action too much. Apparently he wields a dual-handed sword. We have Chiyo. She was the grandmother of the puppet master, the Akatsuki member. I forget his name. We'll get to him in a little bit. And she had the ability to make and control puppets. And it was her and Sakura who took out the one puppet Akatsuki member. There's Rock Lee. He is a student of Guy and looks up to Guy. Love Rock Lee. He has also learned the power of the eight gates. I'm not sure if he knows how to use the gates just yet, or if that happens in some future episodes. I just happened to, I was trying to gather some of this information and to remember, and I happened to notice that about him. So I'm not sure if he has those powers just yet, as far as where we are in the series. But he's most notably known for his drunken fighting style, or drunken fist style, where with even just a sip, a drop of alcohol, his movements and his abilities becomes unpredictable and unstoppable. So that's pretty cool to watch. Doesn't happen that often. I think that mostly took place in the first series of Naruto a couple times. And then next we have the infamous Orochimaru. Again, one of the legendary Sannin. He wanted to basically learn all of the forbidden jutsu, all the knowledge that he could, and obtain immortality. And he did so many experiments with his own body. He eventually, his true form has become a giant white snake. And he uses the snake form to swallow other people's bodies so that he could then use their body, you know, to keep himself going. And he has a lot of different powers, but mostly known for using snakes to attack. And it's quite fitting because he is, when it comes to who he is, his personality, he's a snake, someone that can't be trusted. So next we have Minato, Namikaze, the fourth Hokage and Naruto's father, who sacrificed his life to seal part of the Nine Tails inside of Naruto, so that one day, you know, with the hope that one day Naruto would be able to learn how to control the Nine-Tailed Beast. Next we have Gaara. He's another one of the kids, like Sasuke and Naruto, who, you know, grew up alone, ostracized, and didn't have any parents. Pretty much a sad story like that. He's also a Jinchuriki and has the, or had, the One-Tailed Beast sealed inside of him until the Akatsuki extracted it. He eventually becomes the Kazekage of the village of sand or wind, and he can control and use sand as his power, as a shield to, you know, bury his opponents, things like that. There is Ibiki, one of the members of the Hidden Leaf Village's torture and interrogation force, and I find that a little funny that they would actually call that the torture and interrogation force. He was involved during Pain's attack on the Hidden Leaf, trying to gain knowledge from one of Pain's corpses or subordinates, something like that. Then we have Kabuto, crazy scientist doing experiments to help Orochimaru. We have Karin. She's a sensory type that was helping Sasuke to find his brother Itachi. She almost gets killed during the fight between Sasuke and Danzo. And just as Sasuke is about to kill her, Sakura shows up. So, not sure what happens yet. There's Killer B. He's also a Jinchuriki. He has the eight tails sealed off in him. He's also a great rapper. He's always rapping when he's in a fight, or coming up with new rhymes and writing them down in his little book. He got in a fight with Kisame, the Akatsuki member who basically found him because Killer B got away from a fight with Sasuke, because Sasuke was trying to capture Killer B for the Akatsuki. But then Killer B's brother eventually shows up and they're able to dispatch of and kill Kisame. Let's see, who else? Sai, who was a member of the Anbu Black Ops, I believe, meant to capture Naruto in order to keep him and the Tailed Beast in the Hidden Leaf. He eventually defects and leaves the Black Ops team and becomes a member of Team 7, Kakashi's team, with Naruto and Sakura. And he is somewhat of an artist, so he uses ink and scrolls as his primary ability to create, you know, clones, creatures, or messengers with the ink as his powers. And he was basically brainwashed by the Anbu Black Ops to, like, not have any emotions. So Sai is still in the process of basically trying to be human again. And then we have Shino. He's really cool. He's part of a clan who can control insects. Basically, they have insects stored like under their skin, something like that. So they can use insects to attack for reconnaissance, all kinds of things like that, you know, to summon big clouds of insects, to make a smoke screen type of thing, you know, whatever. And he always has his collar up, so you don't really see much of his face, and he doesn't really show a lot of expressions. He has sunglasses too, so he's a very, Shino is a very calm, cool, and collected type of character, somewhat like Kakashi in that regard. Then there was Suigetsu. He was helping Sasuke find his brother. He's some kind of fish person. He can like change into water or something like that. You know, part of his body can be liquefied, something like that. I think he ends up getting killed during the meeting of the Kages. Then there's Danzo, who was the leader of the Anbu Black Ops, if I'm not mistaken. Did a lot of secret, questionable, suspicious stuff, all in the name of keeping the Hidden Leaf Village safe. Probably a lot of unethical things, a lot of, you know, killing a lot of people. He actually wanted to become Hokage himself, so his plan was to disrupt the missions or the operations of what was transpiring around the time of Pain's attack on the Hidden Leaf. He was hoping that Tsunade would get killed or who knows what, and he eventually gets appointed temporary sixth Hokage. But then during the meeting of the Kages, no one really trusts Danzo. He gets appointed anyway, but then Sasuke shows up and some of the Akatsuki members show up. Danzo, you know, tries to escape. Eventually he does, but he's tracked down by Tobi or Obito, who summons Sasuke, and Sasuke and Danzo end up fighting. You know, Sasuke trying to find out from Danzo if it was true about what happened to Itachi. But Danzo never really shares much information. And eventually Sasuke ends up killing Danzo. Danzo tried to kill Sasuke and Obito with some kind of death seal, where he explodes and tries to trap both of them in his body, but it didn't work. Alright, now we are moving on to the Akatsuki members, starting with the leader, Obito, or Tobi, who you don't really find out is the leader. For the most part, everyone thinks it's Pain, but Obito has been acting as Tobi and kind of pulling the strings from in the shadows. But I believe he is actually Madara Uchiha, or is claiming to be. But I think so far that we think that he is actually Madara Uchiha. Not really sure. And his plan is to gather all the nine-tailed beasts to turn them back into the ten tails so he can assume control of it and then turn the moon into some powerful thing where he would be able to control the entire world, put the entire force peace upon the entire world by like putting them under some giant genjutsu. So that's his plan. And he's also known for his teleportation ability. He can make his body pass through objects, and when you try to attack him, he can make his, you know, body pretty much like invisible. You would still see him, but objects would pass through him. And then there's Nagato, or there was Nagato, also known as Pain, one of the war orphans from the village hidden by Rain. And you find out about, you know, his background and his story, which is another kind of a touching and sad story. And what ends up happening to him and how he becomes consumed with hate and all that as well. But, you know, basically he ends up having a talk with Naruto, and he eventually, you know, sees that Naruto is right, and so he revives everyone that he killed in the Hidden Leaf Village, and then he passes his Rinnegan off to Naruto before he dies. And we also find out that there is a history of war between the Uzumaki clan, Naruto's clan, who Pain was a member of the same clan, and Sasuke's clan, Uchiha, throughout history. The two clans are meant to battle each other forever. So it's destined for Naruto and Sasuke to battle each other as they're part of those two opposing clans. The next Katsuki member is Deidara, known for using clay to make explosive creatures or whatever. He was finally killed in a battle with Kakashi, if I'm not mistaken. There was Hidan. He was the one that used these weird rituals and worshipped some entity known as Jashin. He ends up killing Asuma, but then Shikamaru gets his revenge, ends up killing Hidan. Well, actually, he buries his head, Hidan's head, under the ground. Next, we have Akatsuki member Kagazu. He was able, his power, he could claim the hearts and chakras of his enemies. So he was able to control all five chakra natures. So he was really tough. In order to kill him, you had to kill five of his hearts, so to speak. And it was during a fight with Kakazu, Kakashi, I think Yamato was there, Naruto. We find out Naruto's true potential, the Rasen Shuriken, that he was doing all that training with Jiraiya and Yamato to be able to, you know, use an additional chakra nature. And this Rasen Shuriken has the ability to destroy at a cellular level, but it also hurts Naruto as well. And so Naruto was saying something like, you know, what was the point of all this training to become as powerful as Sasuke if he can't even use the power because it hurts him as well. The next Akatsuki member is Sasori. He controlled puppets. He was brought down by Chiyo, his grandmother, and with the help of Sakura. But I think he basically allowed himself to be killed because he couldn't come to grips with killing his own grandmother. So that was kind of touching as well. You know, and again, you saw some backstory about Chiyo and Sasori. And we actually see that Sasori was another one of these kids who lost his parents when he was young. And Chiyo, his grandmother, took care of him and taught him all about the puppet mastery or chakra. Next, we have Itachi, who ends up joining the Akatsuki, and who is probably also being used by Obito or Tobi for his master plan, as Itachi has the Mangekyo Sharingan, which I think Obito needs for his master plan to come to fruition. But eventually Itachi and Sasuke meet and fight it out. And pretty much Itachi allows himself to be killed by Sasuke, and he passes on the Mangekyo Sharingan on to his little brother Sasuke. Next we have Kisame. He is known as the Tailless Beast because he has the power of a tailed beast without having a tailed beast sealed within him. He has a sword that can extract chakra from his opponents, and he ends up getting beheaded, I believe, by Killer Bee's brother, the Raikage. And then we have Orochimaru, who was a member of the Akatsuki for a brief time before leaving and going off to do his own thing. And then we have Konan, who served alongside Pain. She was able to use paper and origami as her power. She could, I guess, cut you with paper and then, you know, wrap all kinds of paper around you to suffocate you. That was a couple of her powers. And then there's black and white Zetsu, who we haven't really seen all that much except for at the meeting of the Kages. He has some kind of parasitic jutsu. He's able to make clones of himself that absorb the chakra of the user. Seen it briefly in action, but he's still alive and out there, apparently. And I think that's it for the Akatsuki members. Next, let's talk about the tailed beasts. These are the physical forms of chakra created by the sage of the six paths. He created the 9-tailed beasts out of the 10-tailed beast. And the 9-tailed beasts and their hosts, or Jinchuriki, are Gaara and the one tail, Yukito Ni and the two tails, the 3-tailed beast, which was at the bottom of a lake. It was last sealed in someone known as Yagura Karatachi. I'm not really sure if we ever got to see much of that backstory, but Kabuto and a woman named Gurren were trying to obtain the 3-tailed beast, I think for Orochimaru. And then there is Roshi and the 4 tails, or there was. Most of these people have had their tailed beast extracted from them by the Akatsuki. Han and the 5 tails, Utakata and the 6 tails, Fu and the 7 tails, and of course, Killer Bee and the 8 tails, who hasn't been captured yet, and Naruto and the 9 tails. And the last thing to go over are all the different villages. There is the village hidden by rain, village in the land of hot water, the ceramic village in the land of wind, the curtain village in the land of silence, the genjutsu tree village, I think that's a village protected by illusion, the village hidden among stars, howling wolf village, hidden rock village, hidden stone village, village in the land of keys, the heat devil village, village hidden in mist, hidden leaf village, of course, hidden cloud village, village hidden in grass, Mount Katsuragi. This was a mountain protected by a barrier and traps where Hatoru and Tanbi lived, and we could see them for an episode or two. Mount Myoboko, the land of toads, one of 3 sage regions. This is where Jiraiya and Naruto obtain their sage powers and can also summon the toads to help them. Ryuchi Cave, the 2nd sage village, and Shikatsu Forest, damp bone forest, the 3rd of the sage regions. And then there's a village in the land of water, village hidden by sound, the personal hidden village of Orochimaru, Shangri-La, a village in the land of lies, where people with bounties on their heads can live without being hunted. Village hidden in frost. Village hidden by sand, where Gaara is the Kazekage. Village hidden by a waterfall. Village of artisans. Tonika village, where apparently Kabuto has performed his experiments. Hidden moon village. Hidden eddy village in the land of whirlpools. Yugakure, hidden village in the land of hot water. Yukigakure, a hidden village in the land of snow, and Yumegakure, village hidden among dreams in a forest near the land of fire. And that's going to do it for most of the major villages and characters. And that's going to do it for this video. So thank you very much for watching. I hope you found this to be relaxing, and I hope that you enjoy watching or reading Naruto and Naruto Shippuden as much as I do, as much as we do. And I will do I'll do another one of these videos without going over all the characters, but another update on Naruto and Naruto Shippuden well, mostly Naruto Shippuden. As I get further into this show, you know, maybe, you know, towards the second half or towards the end of this year, 2022, and, you know, come back with another update on the, you know, the characters and the stories and what's happened so far since episode 213, and eventually, in another year or so, get to the end of Naruto Shippuden, and maybe eventually watch Boruto. I heard Boruto might not be quite as good, but I don't know, haven't really watched it yet. And of course, there's a bunch of Naruto movies as well. And I might also do another video about Demon Slayer. We've been watching that anime. That's really cool, very stylish. I think a lot more violent as well. So that's another good one. And I probably, I'm not sure if I've done a video talking about Attack on Titan or not, but so a lot of different anime and manga to talk about. So I'll try to keep to this format, I think. If I do, you know, more videos on different anime and manga titles. All right, so that'll do it. So again, thanks for tuning in, and I hope to see you in another video real soon. And until then, take care of yourself. Wish you all my best as you travel down your own path in life. Until next time, take care, and so long for now.